von den Toren.
Thank you.
was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Over our final prayer, seek God's blessing upon us today. Heavenly Father, in your Son Jesus Christ, you have given us a true faith and a sure hope. Strengthen this faith and hope in us all our days, that we may live as those who believe in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May God give you his comfort and his peace, his light and his joy in this world and the next. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you this day and always. Amen. Let us go in the peace of Christ.
Yes, I'm Winston Francis, and I'm one of the Studio One guys. I'm in the entertainment business in 1953, so that is a long time. And Duke Vin, I must say, is that a lot of Duke Vin didn't get the adulation and the respect that he was due, because if it wasn't for Duke Vin and a few guys like himself, I would not be here standing up in England today. So it was because of his handiwork and his love of music, because when a lot of people came to this country as laborers, Duke Vin came here to play music. And when he came to play music, music wasn't a thing that a lot of British people knew about, a lot of Europeans knew about. And he came with one intention, was to publicize Jamaican music, and he certainly did. And his legacy, you know, is on to me and my children, and I guess my children's children. So I have to give thanks to someone like that who made the effort, because of his love of the business, to do so much for the world. Because the biggest music in the world today is reggae music. Believe me when I tell you this. I have played in countries like Argentina that have audiences of over 150,000 people. Yeah? And believe me when I tell you that reggae music is the biggest. They say it's underground music, it's overgrown music, is the largest music in the world today. And we have to give thanks to a man like Vinnie.
Of course.
To say that he was the one who had a vision, like Cox's dad, had the vision where music could go worldwide. And he certainly did. So God bless Vinnie. Indeed. And may his journey be, you know, strong and beautiful, you know, and his resting place be everlasting.
My name is Miller. C.P. Miller, Count Prince Miller. It's not nice to come to these things, but you know, when you come to something like this, for a person like Duke Vin, it's a privilege and a honor. Because I knew Vin when he used to, as a young person in Jamaica, young man, playing. Every time I hear Blue Moon, I think about this man, you know what I'm saying? And the thing about it is that when I came to this country, the back of it, and we
played down the flamingo.
Live music.
Played down the flamingo, I remember the night.
And the marquee. We were playing live music. And the music that we were playing was the music that Duke Vin were playing on record. And it gave people a chance to come out and listen to some live music. Because before that, it was only people like Duke Vin. And he was creating all the entertainment for people. Our people. People who couldn't go to clubs. I mean, he opened the door for people to go to places. Even doesn't matter how much money you had them days, you couldn't get into nowhere. So what you had to do was turn up at one of Duke Vin's gigs. Somebody have a gig and they use Duke Vin to play. That's like how they use a band these days. Vin was the man, you know. So we have a lot, you know, a lot of people take things for granted, but me not turn up at them things, yeah. tell you, you know what I mean? And I come on, I got up this morning at 7 so I could get ready to come here, you know what I'm saying? Because he deserves it, you know, and I'm so proud to see all the people turn out and make it a wonderful day for him.
Indeed.
You know, what and his children. I hope some of his children, you know, take his legacy together and carry it on. Because, I mean, people call me from Jamaica and tell me they're reading about it in the paper in Jamaica. They want to introduce his wife.
But did you know him when he used to spin for Tom?
Tom, yeah, man. Yes,
Tom the Great Sebastian.
Yes. As I'm telling you, those are the, even in Jamaica, those are the music we used to dance. It's R&B, American R&B.
Yeah.
You know, there was no reggae or soca or nothing. It was American R&B.
Yeah.
I mean, people like these rap groups in this country used to go to these guys, people, you know, and get music from them.
Yeah.
So that they could play it, because they like black music. And they couldn't get it to buy. Because it was imported by Duke. And, you
that's
know,
right, that's right.
And so, you know, he deserved whatever people come to see him.
Growing up in the Labour Grove over the years, he's always been an uncle figure. And he used to get a lot of trouble running away listening to him blues, you know, especially the early blues. But he used to know him from the old country as well. And it's so sad, you know, he's had a very, very bad deal where the music business is concerned, yeah? And up to now, you know, it disgusts me to see our music is being hijacked, our culture is being hijacked.
Me,
why do you say that? And I often say, well, you know, if it wasn't for our presence, you wouldn't have the Beatles, you wouldn't have the Rolling Stones, you wouldn't have the Moody Blues, you wouldn't have Led Zeppelin, yes? Yeah? And it all started out from a bloody basement that we, you know, in the 50s, where we couldn't even, where we had to go to create our own entertainment. Yeah? And 30 years later, no, 40 years later, yeah, he still hasn't been recognized. We'd like to get a plaque laid for him to his contribution to what is now British popular music. Yeah? And one of the most disgusting things I always say, yeah? And you know, I can challenge any historian. If it wasn't any, you know, we gave Britain the Beatles, we gave Britain the Rolling Stones, and what's most pathetic these days, we give them Elton John as well, because Elton John learned his craft from Samuel Burke. I know that. We give them John Neal. John Neal learned him craft from Stevie Wonder, yeah? And some of these guys now, yeah, you never see one person of color appearing upon the same bill. In 20 years' time, they're going to say reggae music was a British creation, like what they've done, rhythm and blues and rock and roll. Yeah?
And traditional jazz and all of
that. And traditional jazz, you know? And, you know, we haven't been recognized. And what have you got today? Everything started from a basement, you know? If it wasn't for Duke Vin, would there be a Fat Boy Slim? Would there be a Chemical Brothers? Would there be a Trevor Nelson? Yeah? And the fees these guys met is astronomical.
Yeah.
for burying him today. Had a wonderful service. Unfortunately, there was no video cameras there, so that was the rules of the tune. The church already expressed wishes for family, I'm not sure, but either way. So I'm just going to say a few words that we weren't able to catch, because I was one of the people to give a verbal tribute. We met in the early 80s. Prince Boston, my good friend, said, "Gaz, you can't know music unless you know it, until you know Duke Glenn." So he took me straight round to 29A Lidford Road, and there was the Duke, and I've been a very good friend ever since. Prince Buster, every time he comes to London, always visits. He hadn't actually been to London since 1967. This was like about 84 when we all went round there, when we hooked up, and he always sung Vinnie's praises highly. When Prince Buster was a little boy, with his Sunday school no shoes gang, meaning they only had a pair of shoes for the Sunday, and they all turn up at the dance, little whippersnappers, and the security wouldn't let them in. There was Vinnie, and Prince looked down, and slowly his eyes gazed up. He saw these incredibly shiny patent leather shoes that not a single person he'd ever seen wearing these before. And he looked down and he slowly gazed up. He said, "Wow, the most immaculately dressed man he'd ever seen." And Vinnie says, "Come in, man, come in. Let the boys in, you know." So he came there, and he used to go to Tom the Great Sebastian Sound and listen to the great Duke Vin ever since. And so unfortunately Prince couldn't be here today because he had a stroke a couple of years ago. And so he's infirm in Miami. So he passed on his express condolences, his deepest feelings for the family, and I was able to pass them on to the congregation today. Apart from that, I've just said a few words about what a great man he was and some of the things we did and we hung out. He used to play a lot in my club. We did a few big dances together.
Are you on Talbot Road?
Yeah, and we do the carnival every year. One thing I did mention in the church was like, when he fell ill the last couple of years, he did say, when it looked like he wasn't be able to get down the carnival anymore, he says, "I've got a great idea. Build a bed for me in the DJ tower, and I can DJ from there." So he was always the optimist, you know, and that was typical of the man. And I like the way his eyes just lit up when he come back from like Hamburg or somewhere and just say, "Oh man, you should see them dance, man. My, it's a, oh God, man, them love me, man, them love me." And things like that. And he wasn't an egotist, an egomaniac or anything, but he loved to share the joy and he made a lot of people happy. Yeah, that reminds me, the first time he ever hired the Hammersmith Palais in the 1950s, what a big dance. There was a lot against people dancing the jitterbug and jive dancing, swing dancing as they call it today. So Duke was like, "Well, I don't know about this." So he arrived there and there was a ribbon down the centre of the dance floor. And the women had to dance one side and the men the other. So Duke cut the ribbon. He says, "No, this is not how we dance to this music." And so all the teddy boys used to come to the Hammersmith Palais to listen to the Duke play, because it was the only night they could go and dance there to rhythm and blues, rock and roll, that kind of thing, without having to, you know, go separate sides.
My name is Mandingo. I'm an African from Jamaica, born in Spanish Town, the original capital of Jamaica. I'm a very good friend, and I say I'm because Duke Vin is not dead. I'm a very good friend of Duke Vin. You know, I've known him for over 40 years, you know. I knew his mother in Jamaica, and his son, one of his sons, and I grew up together in Jamaica at Wildman Street, downtown Kingston. Duke is a man who started DJing in the early days, about 1950, for Tom the Great Sebastian Sound. And eventually became the top DJ for the sound. Tom had about three sounds. Tom played one set, his brother played another, Duke Vin played the number two set. But eventually Duke was able to play the number one set, because quite frankly, Tom was the owner, but Duke Vin was the man. And his name in Jamaica was Shine Shoes Vinny, because his shoes was always shine. And he walked with a kind of rag, so that whenever any dust or anything got on his shoes, he shined it. That's why he had the name, you know. And then he came to this country in 1954. He stowed away with two other companions. Came here in 54 and started the first sound system in 1955. He was based in Ladbroke Grove, and that's why the name for his sound was Duke Vin, the champion, you know, from Ladbroke Grove. First sound system, man, as I said, in Britain and Europe, starting from 1955. The man who set the pace, starting in Jamaica, continuing tradition here. And as we know, as African people, music is most important. We use music to communicate with each other in terms of consoling each other, sending messages in times of war that the enemies are coming, etc. Like how the freedom fighters of Jamaica used to use a cow horn, known as their beng, to send coded messages. Today, Friday, the 23rd of November 2012, in Kensal Green Cemetery, West London, where Marcus Garvey was buried, also in 1940, to say that Duke Vin is simply another great and legendary ancestor who has passed on. And long live Duke Vin, long live Marcus Garvey, and long live all our glorious African ancestors. And we must be here to continue to build on the foundation that they left. One God, one aim, one destiny. Mandingo, the Garvey, the proud African from Jamaica.
John Maxwell Worrell. I think I'm an activist or non-activist, as my best way to say. But here's what happened with Vinnie, is that he actually was one out of Dubai, that he was actually a Jamaican and a gentleman. And that's an oxymoron, really. That here's Vinnie in an incredible way. And you were young and you were going to the song systems and you were learning to be a musicologist. And these were the guys who understood all the stuff about where the music came from Jamaica, then they traced it back to the things in New Orleans and so on. Even got back to Duke Ellington. And so you could talk to Vinnie about that stuff. But more than that, Vinnie was someone, I remember that in the very early days, I was working with Denny Cordell. And Denny Cordell had the move in Procol Harum, Joe Cocker and stuff, and I was trying to bring black brothers into the scene, OCB, so I was trying to bring them in. And I remember one day, this little black boy going on with Denny Cordell, and they had Procol Harum, the whitest shade of pale. Remember now, I was 17 years old, and I loved to dance. And I loved Otis Redding. And Denny Cordell is bringing this white record, Procol Harum, and he gives it to Vinnie, and Vinnie plays it. And the crowd erupted, because blacks loved songs. They could do that. I went to Finsbury Park, where people were putting records on for like 2 minutes ago. Me not like that rhythm, you know, hey, go on, and stuff, you know. So I understood that relationship between we as blacks and we as people loving songs. But more than that, was I understood Vinnie's space of where he's, it's almost like a Christ-like figure. I'm not a Christian, but where it is that he understood this in song, where he brought it. Of course, we grew up later, we like Coltrane, we love all that other stuff, and But there's a defense of just only a reggae rhythm of where you Kingston 12 rhythm, a trench town rhythm and stuff. But Vinnie was always someone that you can go, hey, I know you just do that for your work, but we like that. I mean, Vinnie was someone who understood enough about it that he played Hot Chocolate. Can you imagine? The dumbest black record there was by Hot Chocolate. And he will drop that on the, he will drop that on the thing. And remember, this is a place where black people in the Q Club weren't playing Sly Stone. I know they all say they love Jimi Hendrix. And Hendrix was like a spy, you know, like they were like two crazy niggas in the groove. I think I was half of it, and Hendrix was one and a half, really. And so there was never a space that we could do that.
Long before Cox and then. We had Duke Reed before, which I must admit, I have to support Duke Reed all the way, you know. Tower Isles time. Yes, it's very sad. But, you know, what Vin has just manifested is what life is all about. We live and we travel on to that beautiful place of rest. And I know he's gonna meet a lot of other music lovers, players of instruments and singers of songs. And it's gonna be a joyous and a glorious time. So my word to you, brother, is to, and sisters, is right now, when we wake in the morning and find that we can get up and yawn and stretch, give praises unto Jah, because it's only for a time and we must enjoy that time. Vinny has left us a legacy, and I'm going to hand that down to my great-great-grandchildren, because right now I'm having them. It's a very sad occasion here. And not to bore anyone with the doom and gloom, the sun is shining right on me, as you must see the glare from this picture. It even shines brighter while I'm speaking. And Jah know the words is from the heart. My bereavement is so deep in terms of Vinny is like a blood relative. There is no other way of describing the man. The first man to build a sound system here in England. The first man to encounter the attitude and behavior of a police in relation to him playing his music. So he has set a trend. All you young DJs out there now playing your music and, you know, bigging up yourself. Yeah, it's nice to do that. But you must pay respect to the foundation. Without the foundation, there wouldn't be you. And right now, many of you are building your house on a sandy foundation. Won't work. Find a rock and stay firm. Peace, love, honor, respect to you beautiful people. And remember, preach it. One love. Preach it. One love. Blessed love.
Thank you very much, sir.
I want to be your man. that concluded the number of centennial meetings. Now, right now, if you want to just get another job, I'm just doing one thing with each other.
Our people from Jamaica, our people.